In this screencast, we're going to work through an example problem in which we calculate the entrance length to reach fully developed flow. So here we have water that enters a 4-inch diameter piping system from a reservoir with a volumetric flow rate of 50 gallons per minute. We want to determine whether the flow is laminar or turbulent, if during the winter the water temperature is 45 degrees Fahrenheit, and if it reaches 65 degrees Fahrenheit during the summer. What is the length of the pipe that's necessary to reach fully developed flow? So the question first is asking us to determine whether the flow through this pipe is laminar or turbulent. So we have the water entering the pipe from this reservoir, and it will reach a fully developed state after some entrance length. This entrance length will be dependent on whether or not we have laminar or turbulent flow, so therefore it's important to determine that first. So recall, for pipe flow, we calculate the Reynolds number as the density of the fluid times the average velocity through the pipe times the characteristic length, this case its diameter, over the viscosity of the fluid. We could also write this as the velocity times the diameter over the kinematic viscosity of the fluid, depending on which viscosity we use. From our problem statement, we're given a diameter of 4 inches and a flow rate, Q, of 50 gallons per minute. So we know, based on a volumetric flow in the cross-sectional area of the pipe, we could calculate the average velocity. We're given the diameter, so the only thing we need to look up for water is the density and the viscosity, or the kinematic viscosity. So I'm going to write down first the kinematic viscosity at both 45 degrees Fahrenheit and at 65 degrees Fahrenheit. You look these up for water, and I see 1.536 times 10 to the minus 5 feet squared per second at 45 degrees Fahrenheit, and 1.131 times 10 to the minus 5 feet squared per second for 65 degrees Fahrenheit. So now that we have those values, and we could take our diameter and convert from inches to feet, and we get 0.33 feet. Lastly, to calculate the Reynolds number, we're going to need the average velocity. That's just going to be the volumetric flow rate over our cross-sectional area. So we're going to take our 50 gallons per minute and divide by our cross-sectional area, in this case pi times our radius squared. So our radius is going to be 0.167 feet. That's squared. However, these units don't match up. We need to convert our gallons per minute into feet cubed per second. This is going to give us 0.111 feet cubed per second. Now we can plug that into our velocity calculation, and we should get a velocity of 1.28 feet per second. So now we have our velocity, our diameter, and our kinematic viscosities to calculate our Reynolds numbers. So our Reynolds number at 45 degrees Fahrenheit is 2.77 times 10 to the fourth. If we repeat this calculation, we get 3.76 times 10 to the fourth. So indeed, for pipe flow, a Reynolds number greater than 4,000 indicates turbulent flow. So in both cases, we have turbulent flow. So to calculate the entrance length for these two flow profiles, we would use the following relationship, where the entrance length over the diameter of our pipe is going to equal 4.4 times the Reynolds number to the 1/6. So if we set this up for our first flow at 45 degrees Fahrenheit, we get an entrance length of 8.06 feet. So it would take 8.06 feet of pipe to reach fully developed flow. Now, if we repeat this, for flow at 65 degrees Fahrenheit, we get 8.49 feet. So indeed, as we increase the temperature, we would expect a higher entrance length into the pipe because our Reynolds number is increased due to the lower viscosity of our fluid. So hopefully this gives you an idea on how to calculate the entrance length to reach fully developed flow for pipe flow.